Okay. I'm excited and I'm also, okay. Well, I'll start. So I'm thrilled to death to be hosting this panel with four writers whom I respect so much, Lenore, Keeshig, Shani, Mootoo, Madeleine, Thien, and George Elliott Clarke, all of whom have played major roles in shaping my own thinking about creativity, race, racialization, culture, community, and compassion. This panel is entitled Respect, Relation, and Coalition. And one of the things that's sort of really striking me this sort of 20th or 21 years after writing for race, remembering it, is the heartfelt attempt made by many of us to work in coalition at a moment in the cultural history of this place that some call Canada, that we should probably be calling Turtle Island, probably, we should definitely be calling Turtle Island, when the language and analysis for coalitional work was going through a lot of growing pains. But also it was a time when there was so much energy for the labor of what Cornell West called cultural race politics. We've done a lot together, and many friendships and alliances were built, and I think much of the energy that we're feeling in the room today comes from the building of those alliances in that time, right? I know I'm feeling it myself almost to the point where it's a little bit overwhelming. And I'm very aware of the ways in which the mainstream attempted to frame the conference along the lines of a single binary, white and color, without recognizing nuance in either term, so all the kind of complexities of whiteness, all the complexities and all the diversity has become such a buzzword, it's almost, you know, emptied of its meaning, but the sort of vast array of difference that sort of presents itself, right, in the communities that came together to make the conference Writing Through Race happen. I really appreciated what both Lee and Lillian had to say in the last panel about, the necessity of writing and talking for one another. And I think that's right. The storytelling, the writing, the talking, and the meal sharing were so important as ways of, building community. And then by the same token, there were differences. And it's important for me also to sort of recognize those. I think each of us perhaps experienced those differently. Our differences are attached to complicated sets of real material histories. And when we were doing this work, we attached different names to ourselves depending on how we were working. So all the names of Indigenous nations, Coast Salish, Blackfoot, Cree, Métis, Mohawk, Anishinaabe, and more, the names, names attached to blackness, Black Caribbean, African-Canadian, Black Nova Scotian, and more, all the names attached to Asianness, Chinese, Japanese, and Chinese-Canadian, Japanese-Canadian, Filipino, Vietnamese-Canadian, Korean-Canadian, and more. And then all the sort of cross-throughs with, GBLTQ, trans, disabilities, /PIP, folks and issues, the question of class, histories that needed to be remembered, the residential schools, of course, the Chinese head tax issue, racist policing against black folks in Toronto, the history of black Nova Scotians, the Komagata Maru. There's so many material histories that sort of seem to, disappear on the mainstream stage that we were carrying, right, in these very complex kinds of ways. And not necessarily knowing them or knowing them well. Our own histories leave alone those, right? So when Lee is talking about the research that she did to write a meaningful blurb for her Chinese-Canadian writer, friend and colleague, this is so important. And we were just beginning to do that kind of work at that time. We had strategies, we had the tools. I do believe that there was an extreme amount of energy and goodwill, and yet sometimes it was also difficult. And I would like to acknowledge that and also, I suppose, pose it as a complex of questions for the panel. The other quick thing I want to recognize and I want to go on to is that the moment of writing through race was the moment, in fact, when there was a massive economic turn happening globally. We call it neoliberalism, right? So we're in that moment of the shift from a kind of old nationalist liberalism to a new and newly nationalist neoliberalism. And its economic forms took on a different kind of, different but very related kinds of work. And I think that this conference was sort of caught in the whirlwind of this more than I was aware, anyway. Maybe some of us were more. So I offered the panelists a set of questions to sort of think about, and I'll sort of spin some of them out again. So some of the questions would be, is there a precedent for our untriangulated relationships with one another, historically and genealogically, by which I mean, you know, among variously racialized folks of color and indigenous folks, relationships that are not triangulated through whiteness, because I think that that's the way when we don't think about it, we imagine ourselves called into being. It's obviously much more complicated than that. But also, can we use the way that the state triangulates us for radical social justice purposes, for the purpose of good relationships? What kinds of oppositions, coalitions, conversations, and poetics could be set up across and within different terms in different communities? What were the ways that we organized together that were really successful? What conversations do we carry into the present? What ideas, practices, stories, histories do we work through then? How do those resonate now? My eye is, of course, on the present. What do various communities want now? Can we help one another? How? What acknowledgments need to be made? What actions need to be taken? And to what ends? What are the barriers to building respect and coalition now? Where are the generative possibilities? Did writing through race lay groundwork for good relation now? What form did it take? Was it built well? Were there blind spots? I could keep giving the questions, right? But there's a sort of a little sampling of the things going through my head as I sort of think about the work of this panel. Okay, enough literature. It gives me great pleasure to introduce these four wonderful panelists. I'm going to introduce them and then just sort of let them take the stage. And I guess I'll just remind the panelists a 7 to 10 minute provocation, and then we'll open the floor. So it's a slightly different format from the lovely session that David Charlie and Andy hosted this morning. So Lenore Keeshig Tobias is going to speak first. Lenore Keeshig is of the Wolf Clan, and is a traditional storyteller and award-winning author of the Chickawas of Nawash Unceded First Nation on the Saugeen Peninsula, known as the Bruce Peninsula. She coordinates the interpretive program for the Bruce Peninsula National Park and Fathom 5 National Marine Park in Tobermory. As a traditional storyteller, Lee has always had a personal interest in the truth documented in traditional Anishinaabe stories, and is working to show the parallels between these ancient stories and current geologic research. Keeshig's poetry appears in a number of anthologies. Her first book of poetry will be published, will be published this fall, 2015, by Quattro Books. Congratulations, that's awesome. Woo! Primarily an author of stories for children, she produced two bilingual Ojibwe and English books, Bird Talk and Emma and the Tree, and in 2005 co-authored The Truth About Nibbles with her husband David McLaren. Bird Talk won the 1993 Living the Dream Book Award, which is an award commemorating Dr. Martin Luther King. Prior to accepting employment with Parks Canada, Lenore taught at George Brown College in Toronto, served a five-year term as the chair for the Chippewas of Nawash Board of Education, and served on the Anti-Racism Ethnocultural Equity Committee for the Bruce County Board of Education, now Blue Water District School Board. Before returning home to Nawash also known as Kate Croker in 1992. She served as the founding chair, I know I sing myself here, I do, and she served as the founding chair for the Racial Minority Writers Committee of the Writers Union of Canada in 1991. Earlier, she, with Daniel David Moses and Thompson Hanway, co-founded the Committee to Reestablish the Trickster, a group established to foster and promote Aboriginal writers. Madeleine Thien is going to speak next, and I'm just realizing that I forgot to say a couple of things announcement-wise. So I might just interject those, so you don't have to see my mug after this. We are going to be conducting a couple of the teaching assistants who have been helping at this conference are going to be conducting some mini interviews about the events today. And if you are interested in being interviewed and speaking, you know, on the record about your thoughts, feelings, ideas, concerns, Patna is the man to speak to, and he's over here down front. And the other thing I should tell you is that there's coffee at the Grange, right across the street, so if lineups get too long, on the other side. Okay. So the second speaker is going to be Madeleine Thien. She's the author of 3 books of fiction, including her most recent novel, Dogs at the Perimeter, which was the finalist of the 2014 International Literature Prize awarded in Berlin. She's a recipient of the City of Vancouver Book Award, the Ethel Wilson Fiction Prize, and the Amazon.ca First Novel Award, as well as the Ovid Festival Prize. And her writing has appeared in The Guardian, Granta, Pan America, Asia Literary Review, see, I can't pronounce English either, and Brit. And her books have been translated into 22 languages. Since 2010, she's been part of international faculty in the MFA program at City University of Hong Kong. After Madeleine, Shani Mootoo is going to speak. Shani Mootoo was born in Ireland and grew up in Trinidad. Her acclaimed first novel, Serious Blooms at Night, was published worldwide and was a finalist for the Giller Prize and longlisted for the Man Booker Prize. Her second novel, Who Drowned She in the Sea, was on the long list for the International Impact Dublin Literary Award. Her third, Valmiki's Daughter, and her most recent, Moving Forward Sideways Like a Crab, were long listed for the Scotiabank Giller Prize. Mootoo immigrated to Canada more than 30 years ago, and she's currently writer in residence at the University of Toronto. And then our final, but far from most diminished speaker, will be George Elliott Clarke. George Elliott Clarke, Poet Laureate of Toronto, 2012-15, is an Afro-Canadian, African Nova Scotian. A prized poet, his 13th work is Traverse, an autobiographical poem. His forthcoming title is the epic poem, The Canticles, whose subject is slavery, to be published over 5 years beginning fall 2016. Currently the inaugural E.J. Pratt Professor of Canadian Literature at the University of Toronto, Clarke has also taught at Duke University, McGill University, the University of British Columbia, and Harvard University. He's won several awards for his poetry and a novel, and received 8 honorary doctorates plus appointments to the Order of Nova Scotia and the Order of Canada at the rank of officer. So if you please welcome all 4 of them in, and then I'll...
I just thought I'd use a little bit of my language that I know. I told you my name is Lenore. I told you my Ngun, the wolf. Ndodam is my clan or my extended family. Miashingani, that beautiful point of land partially surrounded by water. Ndonjaba is where my sound comes from. So my sound, my my breath, my voice, my perspective comes from that place, that beautiful point of land partially surrounded by water. Meanwhile, and Sakin Niasin, aka Bruce Peninsula, is also where I come from because that is part of the traditional homeland of my people, my nations. Now, you wanted a bit of history? Well, I think it actually all starts with that man over there, Daniel David Moses. He doesn't remember, but he was a member of the Writers' Union of Canada. And we had already been working together. We organized the committee to reestablish the Trickster. Dan Moses, myself, Thompson Howard. I think Drew Hayden Taylor was around somewhere. But the idea was that we wanted to foster and promote Aboriginal writing, Aboriginal voice. But Dan was a member of the Writers Union of Canada. And after I had my first book published, he said to me, he said, Lenore, why didn't you become a member? You have a book? He says, it's pretty lonely there. So I joined. And, it was just kind of like the two of us, because there were no writers of color at all, except for me and Dan. And so I guess it was around that time. Well, let me think back now. I had been listening to a CBC radio show. I don't remember the name of it. But there was a discussion in that show about white Canadian women appropriating the voice of black women. Now, I don't know, maybe some of you can help me and remember what the name of that show was and who were the women there speaking. And I listened very carefully because I knew what that felt like. I knew what it felt like to be paraphrased and have someone take your story and write about it and then become the expert. So I told Dan, I asked him if he had heard that, and we talked briefly about it. And I told him I was going to speak up somehow. I was going to stand up and say something because I knew what it felt like. And how it actually came about within the union, I really can't recall. But I do know that we did make a stand at one of the AGMs. Okay, this is where I need help. This is where I need help, but I do remember there was this particular forum that they were going to talk about Aboriginal voice, and Daniel and I were sitting in the back, and of course there were no, they didn't, us being, Daniel and I being the only First Nations Aboriginal members in the union, they hadn't even asked us if we would be part of a panel for that particular discussion. So, finally, I think at one point I got up and said, wait a minute, you know, and I remember grabbing Dan's arm and saying, okay, Dan, let's go. And we marched down to the front, and of course the moderator there, Brian Brett, I believe, wanted to get some kind of consensus from the audience as to whether or not Daniel and I could go up and represent First Nations voice. And we said, heck no, you can't do that. We're here. So, you know, you want the real thing, then it comes from us. And that was, I think, the beginning of the discussions within the Writers' Union. And holy moly. Yeah, there were skirmishes here and there. And it got to be pretty nasty at times. So very nasty. That's my question.
suppose the question would be, you know, because I recall, one thing I neglected to say is I was such a squirt at that time, right? I was very young, and but I was bad. And I remember a lot of backlash, you know, often against me personally, from people who felt a lot of righteous entitlement to land, to voice, to all those kinds of things that I think any of us who are marked or recognize when marked differently don't necessarily feel so entitled to. And what I remember and admire and carry with me is recollection of you just refusing to let the bullshit stand.
That's probably why I became inactive after the writing through race conference. I'm home to lick my wounds and look after my children. Well, I've been largely inactive since that time. And so I'm kind of playing catch up in a way. What's so awesome about coming here is to have our circle reconnect again. And I think what's even more awesome is the fact that there are like circles within circles. And that we're all coming here. And it shows me just how interrelated or interconnected we are. That somehow, well, we know what each other feels like. And the best way of talking about that is telling our own stories. Because it's when we tell our own stories and speak about our own experiences, and again, being very subjective about it, that's how we end up with this shared emotion and shared vision, because people can, people then can, they feel the emotion, and they know the connections.
I want to begin by thanking Larissa and Vera and Shani for bringing us together. It's been an honor to be here. And an honor to share the story with you. Larissa said she was a squirt in 1994 and she was there. And I have to say I was a squirt in 1994 and I was not there. So it's a great deal of trepidation that I saw my private person. In 1994, I was 20 years old, and I had only just begun to write fiction. It would be another 7 years before I published my first book. When the media reports about writing to race entered my mother's living room, the response in my home was one of first startled confusion, the pure shock of seeing non-white writers on the evening news, followed by unease. Writers who were not only questioning, but calmly confronting Canadian society and its institutions, emblems my family viewed with a mixture of pride and passion. My reaction to the news coverage was physical. I felt ill at ease and fearful. In my family's home in Vancouver, as in the homes of many newcomers at that time, we saw a child, dependent, talking back to an authority figure. Protest is for white people, for giving peace, perhaps for the iron workers, but who are we to protest injustices? Our daily bread and survival was earned through the juggling of multiple jobs behind fast food counters, in shopping malls and kitchens, cookie factories, flea markets, youth furniture stores, dollar stores, as curtain makers, seamstresses, manicurists, accountants, as small business owners with dreams of prosperity. Vancouver's Chinese community had learned to rely upon itself, to pass jobs, cars, math lessons, business ideas, real estate, news, phone cards, imported groceries, and dreams within its own self-sufficient circulatory system. In 1994, I saw Writing Two Ways only to music works of contradiction, reverse racism, and quote-unquote apartheid. And it stayed with me, as I was on my own, the daughter of a bankrupt father who could no longer survive on my own. I didn't want to think about Writing Two Ways. I wanted only to live more, to pass through all the lines that etched Vancouver, socioeconomic and racial borders that still exist. I wanted to be as invisible as those lines appeared to be. Like others here today, I came from a world of abuse, suicide, violence, financial disaster, and sorrow, a world of secrets and unbearable quiet. What could a child aspire to except to leave and disappear and efface one's own identity? As a 20-year-old woman aspiring to write fiction, I was afraid to be mocked by the brush of identity politics, to be seen as militant, as a threat, as a racist, and perhaps most of all, as unworthy. At the University of British Columbia, where I was studying, my voice felt disconnected from me. When I wrote about growing up in Strathcona and the downtown east side, I was told not to take advantage of this, according to them, infamous community from my stories. When I wrote about the rebellions in China in the 19th century and the mythologies that they gave rise to, I was told that I was mistaken folklore for history, feudalism for modernity. Slowly, race disappeared from my work. But what I refused to let go of was the feeling. I might not have revealed the color of their skin, but I knew my characters through their invisibility. I've always wondered, if a racialized person willingly embraces this invisibility, if they accept there can only be one among 1 billion faceless people, if they must be part of the tide of immigration swamping this country, if they can only be a body but never a soul, if they submit to this disappearance, will they be free? This invisibility is demanded of minorities, First Nations, lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender individuals, and we in the arts community are not immune. The act of being an invisible writer is both a liberating choice and a sad one. Fiction asks us to vanish, to give everything we once owned or will ever own to the characters we bring to life. Fiction asks us to take everything we know and to transform it into another form. We writers of color have lived, I hope, another idea of coalition, one in which we read widely. We inhabit the history that our society has removed from the frame of our vision. We bring that history to everything we do and touch and see. We don't let it get away from us, and we persist in seeing it and articulating it. We embrace it as part of who we had to become, even when our literary culture again and again reduces it. A literary culture that sidelines the work of so many writers as political, as ethnic, as immigrant literature, as not Canadian, as foreign, as, to quote Philip Marchand, of interest only to scholars of comparative literature. Personhood is the most sought term of all, a word from which people of color, to greater and lesser degrees, are excluded. Instead, we are forced to be emblems of the world outside, of histories elsewhere, and of society's ruptures. Writing Through Race was a counter-narrative, and its strength was not exclusion, but radical inclusion. Its workshops allowed writers to be invisible, and yet to be seen to themselves. Just as in the writing of literature, we glimpse not only the humanity of our characters, but of ourselves. Writing Through Race changed us because we entered rooms in which personhood was given freely. And more importantly, it was taken freely, as was our right.
I'm going to try to answer some of Larissa's, the questions that Larissa posed about background and about a particular now, and actually Marie touchdown on the moon. In 1991, 3 years before the writing Thru Race Contest, when I was more of a visual artist than a writer, I was one of a group of artists of South Asian heritage who engaged in an action against the Vancouver Art Gallery. It was the first time that such a thing had happened in that gallery's history. Briefly, the VAG was about to hold an opening night party for an exhibition called Fabled Territories, of works by British South Asians. Sitapa Biswas was the only artist from Britain at the event. And a couple of days before the opening, I hosted a little get-together to introduce her to South Asian colored artists, writers, and activists. I say it this way because I do identify more with the Caribbean aspect of my visibility. Sitapa was excited to meet us and expressed the expectation that we'd be attending the opening. But we weren't even aware of the existence of an opening event. She got in touch with the VAG and asked for us to be invited and was told that it was for members only. No outreach had been done to communities who would have had a connection to the work or the concerns of those artists. So we got in touch with the VAG ourselves and asked, we begged even, but were told no, we could not attend. We decided to show up anyway, but as a protest outside with placards. Word got around and we were joined by other groups of artists who saw themselves marginalized by the VAG itself and the art systems in Canada in general. The protest was all over the national news, and a couple of weeks later, after more public pressure and too much negative national press, the VAG invited us to meet with them. By this time, we were joined by many more who saw themselves as left out of mainstream cultural programming, but also local theatre companies, publishers, all run by whiteboards and management, and with little or no programming that reflected anything besides their own world, asked to be part of the meeting. It was just after that meeting of arts administrators, Indigenous artists, artists of various colors, and lesbian and gay artists, a group so large that a theatre space had to be used to house the event, that some of us practicing artists were asked to either sit on the board of the galleries, theatres, and publishing houses, or to come in and advise them on our groups. I watched many very good artists who saw an opportunity to be finally of value and to get a monthly salary, stop making their excellent art, and become entrenched in administration. I too sat on a theatre board for a while, but I quickly saw that I was going to have to make a choice between being a full-time artist and devoting my time to art administration. I recall that when we started getting positions in arts administration, and our friends were taking up positions at universities and art colleges, and we were getting exhibitions, and our novels started getting published, we had such high hopes that our presence would make institutions change. It was a time of ebullience for artists, but not just because we were cultural producers involved in activism. We really were into spontaneous, collaborative projects celebrating our differences, not just from the mainstream, but from each other, and in dialogue with each other. In the end, we were, I think, unprepared for how tenacious institutions are and how difficult it would be to affect real change. My writing career came out of that time with Press Gang, the collective women's press in Vancouver, asking me to write for them as they actively sought out writers of color to add to the stable that already included Lee, Maricola, and Sky Lee. The VAG incident that came out of it didn't have the kind of historical analysis then as the writing through race events had, because I think artists had no union, because that series of events I outlined earlier came out of sometimes spontaneous grassroots activism, and because we as artists that time tended to treasure our individual difference as each individual's unique signature, perhaps more than writers do. But out of that time came a tiny coalition of artists of color right across the country that led to the Banff Center's Race and the Body Politic residency headed up by Chris Pate and Kelly, where it was the first time ever that a residency was made up of people of color. Out of 18 residents, in fact, there was only one white person, Wendy Overlander, who took the teasing well that she was out of silk and white. Remember that. It was an attempt at creating and inhabiting a space of respect, inclusion, and coalition making here in Canada. That same year, Chris Clayton Kelly and I curated a show of Vancouver artists about Asian heritage at the Vancouver Cultural Centre called To Visit the Tiger, in response to the VAG show a year earlier. In 1993, there was the Racy Sexy exhibition sponsored by the Chinese Cultural Centre of Vancouver, whose catalogue, this might sound like something that happens now, but then it was an amazing thing, whose catalogue included a Punjabi translation in state. This show was put together by a coalition of the most diverse individuals and included artists and renters. Some of these shows, the people here who were in these shows, Dion Bryan, Roy, Larissa, Estelle Mathieu, Fuse magazine was at its most vibrant in those days, and Rung, which started out as a South Asian magazine of the arts, quickly opened up to include the voices of the various communities. The Desperdesh Festival always attacked with sold-out audiences, made up of people from every racialized group that exists in the city and beyond. It was perhaps one of the most creative and successful times of coalition the country has seen. Prescan published my first short story collection, Out on Main Street, in 1992, and Sirius Bloom's account, my first novel, in 1996, 2 years after the writing of the Race Conference, and which coincided with the new awareness that came, I think, out of that heady heyday of vibrant activism in the arts in general. It was a new awareness in many walks of life, including at the university, of us, of writers, that is, and artists of color, gays and lesbians. We'd been working for a long time, but suddenly we were brought out of our ghettos. We'd been working, and I say brought out because in many ways it was still the hand of power making the decisions. Our work got taken up and devoured by a mainstream whose eyes seemed suddenly to have opened to our presence. The work seemed to be groundbreaking at the time, but I think it was really audiences, including the university crowd, who were the ones breaking ground by being receptive to these culture producers and to the product, to the subject of our work, which inevitably dealt with issues of identity. This receptivity allowed me to hone my craft and create more work, and it appeared to me that I was being brought out again into the light. But 20 years on, I'm wondering if I've been stuck in another ghetto, and it is this that makes this revisiting of the earlier impetus of writing through race so poignant for me today. My career as a writer, specifically as a writer of color, is very much influenced by, or perhaps at the mercy of, a number of factors: the publishing industry, book design, marketing, the zeitgeist, technology, audience rating systems, mainstream reviewers, literary prizes, to name a few. I can't address them all as much as I'd like to, because I know that a great deal that we've fought for and in some areas achieved has reverted. But I'd like to look at one arena that has really kept my work alive and made Sirius Blooms at Night a bestseller of over 22,000 copies just to date. This, in Canada, this arena is the university. It is in universities, it is through professors and students in queer courses and courses that focus on race and post-colonialism that my writing has really thrived. I have great appreciation for what has been done with me and my work in these institutions. So it isn't easy for me to say the following, which is that I've come to see that it is not really my work that has been paid this attention. It is Sirius Blooms at Night. In fact, my work of four novels, one book for short stories, and a book of poetry has been relegated to another ghetto, one created through their absence when taken into this larger context in the university. And I should say that although I talk of me and of my work, I see this, this is true for many of us writers of color and those of us who are queer too. What I mean is, save for the works that came out of that hot politically charged period in the 90s, save that is for those novels that were doubtlessly important works back then, and some of which are indeed great works and that are already on course list, there's not much new work, some but not much, either by those same queer or race art writers or by new ones being added to the canon. It happened that many of us who were taken up had just written our first novels, and equally important, we were being published by presses that had not had a history of publishing people from these particular marginalized groups, and therefore had not carried such subject matter before. One can't help but wonder if, say, the queerness, of which race seems to be a part, but is mandatory for inclusion in the present book canon, is imagined only to be authentic and first words that came out at a time where such queerness had political currency and became topical. Is queer and racialized writing that is worth paying attention to a thing of the past? Wouldn't it be interesting to see how those very issues are being dealt with today by those same writers? We're currently writing in the context of a time and place where a great deal has changed for the better and for the worse regarding issues of identity, and at the same time where much, as we know, is really the same. It's all there in the recent works, the current works. Why not go to these current works of those very authors, as long as the current works are really, of course, who were thought to be breaking ground to see the journey we've taken and the distance we've come since those critical days. Speaking for myself, please understand this is not a plug for my work, but I'm trying to make an important point. Speaking for myself, I think moving towards sideways is as advanced for its time as Sirius was for it, and is also, in my view, a much more mature book in every way. But in the context of a time when race and LGBT issues seem passé, and a bit of a bother, boring, sort of like the stuff from back then, not really contemporary, will it be picked up at universities? It's too soon to know, of course, but I believe this is the issue that is germane to this conference. One of the issues. This brings me to the question of co-optation. Perhaps a cycle is inevitable. First activism, then acceptance into art administration or academic jobs, which over time evolves into taking on the values of the institutions we work for. Then another round of activism to challenge our now entrenched positions. And perhaps this is how it should be. Battles like ours are never really won, but they're ongoing. Speaking from my experience only, I can say that I am invited often to speak at universities, but always it is on the topic of failure. And I'm wondering if in maintaining a canon put together some 20 years ago, might there not be a mindless kind of ghettoization, and by extension, a kind of unmeant racism at work here too, that goes against the spirit of the earlier years of activism in which the first writing through race conference emerged? If we're not to remain tokens, might it not be better if those of us who got named queer or who were raised because of our first books came to be seen as real writers whose bodies, because of our bodies of work, some of which might be explicitly queer and race, and others not? Thank you.
I'd like to begin basically by just reading some notes that I've taken over the last half hour, 45 minutes or so. Things have just occurred to me off the top of my head, sorry. But anyway, I think it's important to remember the historical context of writing through race in terms of it falling upon two other major controversies centered in the city of Toronto involving race. And they were, of course, the Royal Ontario Museum controversy over the Out of Africa exhibit, early 1992. Also, the controversy over the staging of Showboat at then North York Performing Arts Center, 1993. And then, of course, Writing Through Race occurs. And then the fallout of the controversy over Writing Through Race, I believe, served to help put Mike Harris in power here in Ontario. Given the fact that he was able to utilize an angry white male vote in order to carry the day, which also saw that that vote, in fact, was real, and according to the posters, it was. There was an angry white male backlash, so to speak, in the election campaign of 1995 in Ontario, partly, I think, about all these news stories, and reactions to all these news stories about, in quotation marks, uppity folks of color and First Nations people demanding rights, demanding equality, et cetera, et cetera. While at the same time, they were experiencing a great deal of economic struggle because of the passage of NAFTA and the FTA earlier and the shutting down of the manufacturing sector in Ontario for the most part, all of which helped contribute to a collapse of the NDP here provincially in 1995. And one of the first things that Mike Harris did, of course, when he got into power, was to unleash the OPP on Native protesters, most notably, of course, with Ipawash protests, resulting in the police murder of Dudley George. And, of course, there are many other elements that could be rolled into all of this. And I'm just getting started, but I'm going to go a little bit faster and get to the substance of this discussion for myself, which is my response to Larissa's chapter in her excellent book, Slanting Eye, Imagining We, Asian Canadian Literary Production in the 1980s, 1990s, just published Wilfrid Laurier University Press. And her final chapter, of course, takes up writing through race. And she makes poignant assertions that produce reflection. First, she reminds us of, I really like this phrase, quote, a politics of time and a time of politics, unquote, to admit that her own attempt to recover a progressive or radical purpose effect the constituency around writing through race is immediately compromised due to what she describes in the past 20 years as the collapse of anti-racist community and the rise, in her words, of neoliberalism, high capital, and empire. Now, Larissa is courageously correct to identify a recollection of writing through race as inviting discourse that immediately feels, and I quote her again, contradictorily dated, forgotten, and yet still overdetermined. There's an ennui in her statement that echoes the bitter nostalgia of earlier radical moments, whose moments have seemingly passed away, virtually without mourning, leaving in their wake guerrillas who have become stockbrokers and eco-radicals who sell condos. We can take our pick of similar moments of revolutionary possibility thwarted, from May 68 in France to the invasion of Grenada, 1983. Marcuse says in A Theory of Liberation, written immediately after the events of May 68, quote, the poetry and songs of protest were either too late or too early, memory or dream, unquote. A sense of Weltschmerz overcomes the original enthusiasm, and a sense of the sorrow pervades Larissa's essay, despite its hopeful notes and her conclusion. Indeed, it's almost for me as if she's turned from Mao's brilliant essay on contradiction, only to end up trapped in Francis Fukuyama's triumphalist paean on to neoliberal globalization, The End of History, 1989. And I should mention that I regret that Larissa does not attend to Fukuyama's masterful praise of Occidental and American hegemony, in which, by the way, he predicts the dissolution of the Soviet Union, because this essay is likely the most influential work by an Asian intellectual since, in fact, Mao's writings inspired radicals in ex-colonial new nations in the mid-1950s and 1960s, and, of course, also informed the thought of the United States Black Panther Party for Self-Defense. It is also interesting to me that the somewhat gloomy tone of Larissa's opening paragraph is tempered by her recourse to the Foucauldian notion of the archive. And I applaud this term in her thought, because it is the same term that Foucault himself makes, again, as a direct result of what he saw as a defeat of the French left in that instant of revolutionary exhilaration that was May 68. In an interview with still exuberant young socialists in the fall of 1968, Foucault already speaks of the revolutionary moment as being passé. He warns, quote, a revolutionary undertaking is directed against the rule of until now, meaning, presumably, that a revolutionary must appreciate that to deem existing circumstances as new is, in fact, propaganda against insurgency. In other words, there are always precedents, antecedents, and ancestors. So Larissa is correct to assume writing through race from the dustbin of history and to view it not as has-been, as passé, but as déjà vu, as a prototype of more salient and effective forms of anti-racist organization and interracial solidarity that remain to be realized. Larissa gestures precisely in this direction by listing what were or are seminal moments, in particular, of Asian-Canadian consciousness raising and coalition construction, naming, for instance, the 1989 Women's Film Video Festival, Invisible Colors, and the 1992 Writers Union of Canada Conference, The Appropriate Voice. She also names Asian-Canadian activism in support of First Nations during the 1990 Oka Crisis as a key moment in this archive, but also recalls the 1989 collapse of the Berlin Wall, the 2001 guerrilla attacks on New York and Washington, the 1997 return, in quotation marks, of Hong Kong to the People's Republic of China, and even the 1973 toppling of Chile's Salvador Allende by the bloody dictator Augusto Pinochet as, she says, key global events impinging upon the saliency of anti-racist protests and politics in Canada. And again, Larissa is correct to allow these observations, but other dates are likely just as vital, such as the consolidation of the People's Republic of China in 1949, the liberation of India from British sovereignty in 1947, the French defeat in Vietnam in 1954, followed by the American defeat in Vietnam in 1975, the Nixon visit to China in 1972, the war between Vietnam and China in 1970-79, the rise of G8 economic power of Japan, and the rise of G20 economic power of China in the 1990s. And I'll just note, I think the last statistic I heard, China will have the world's largest economy in 2020, not that far away. The Japanese-Canadian Redress Agreement of 1988, the W5 segment in 1978 claiming that Chinese students were overrunning Canadian campuses, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I would continue to name so many dates of relative importance that my obvious point would begin to seem farcical. Yet, I do believe this point is true, namely that, quote, a time of politics is always the politics of time. In other words, struggle of opposites is ceaseless, as Mao says, and if so, there can never be a moment of final success or final defeat. In other words, anti-racist struggle happened before writing through race, continues to happen now, and will also continue long into the future. While it is good to examine writing through race, it is only as much agency or urgency as do the events of May 68 in France, or the Idle No More, Arab Spring, and Occupy movements of 2011-13, all of which are closer to us in time, but also now just as remote, except for whatever useful memory we can retrieve from their respective archives. I close with several more dates that inform my response. First, it's now 50 years since Malcolm X, or Elhaz Malik al-Shabazz, was assassinated. He deserves to be remembered not only as a necessary counterweight to the sentimental rhetoric of Martin Luther King, but also as a keen student of geopolitics. In 1964, he was one of the first, and he might have been the very first, public figure to predict American defeat in Vietnam. That same year, he predicted that Chinese and Arabic would be the languages of the future. What was his future is, in fact, our present. In his later speeches, X pointed to the Bandung Conference of 1954 as a model for the unity of the non-Euro-American Caucasian aligned nations. And he often pointed back to that conference in his later speeches, Bandung, B-A-N-D, as in David E-N-G, which was specifically a gathering of nations with majorities of people of color, and pointedly refusing to allow white-dominated nations to be part of it, which is very upsetting. And in fact, it's never been repeated. That kind of gathering has never been repeated. But in any event, X noted himself how upset white majority nations were that they weren't invited to sit down with the decolonizing nations of Africa and Asia, but had to sit on the sidelines while their former subjects began to dream of a world no longer ruled by white supremacy. Bandung was the real long-distance precursor of the Writing Through Race Conference, and still a model for anti-racist activism today. Finally, I'm going to mention 1997 as another key year. And this, for me, has to do with the coming into popular consciousness in Canada of something called Black or African Canadian writing. That year saw the release of Ronaldo Alcott's Black Light 2, Writing Black Canada, Dion Brand's poetry collection, Lands of Light On, which received the Governor General's Award for Poetry, Rachel Manley's memoir, which received the Governor General's Award for Nonfiction, Janet Sears' play Harlan Duet, which received the Governor General's Award for Drama, Lawrence Hill's novel, Any Known Blood, Emner Baby Phillips' essay collection, Genealogy of Resistance, Cecil Foster's novel, Slam and Time, Andrew Moody's controversial play, Riot, Mary Starfield's important historical novel, No Crystal Spirit, Hazel Palmer's touching short stories, But Where Are You Really From?, Peter Hudson's edited special issue of West Coast Line dedicated to new African Canadian writing, white scholar Robin Lynch's much rightly criticized The Blacks in Canada, A History, was reissued that year by McGill Queen's University Press with a preface by Austin Clarke. Austin Clarke's eighth novel, The Origin of Wings, appeared that year. I'll also throw in my bibliography of African Canadian Letters, which appeared in Canadian Ethnic Studies, and my anthology, I Am the North Star, Directions in African Canadian Literature. That same year, there were also productions of plays by Lorena Gale and myself at the Salafi Conference in Toronto. Mary Starfield also organized a cross-country international tour of Afro-Canadian writers, looking into the archive of 1997, so to speak. I think we could say that quarrels over Black / African Canadian identity and history helped to usher, in fact, many publications and simply writers into being. However, it would be an error to fixate nostalgically on that year. In the end, every text both imprisons a psychological / cultural history, as well as becoming itself a prisoner of the social, political, and cultural material history of its own production. Every text imprisons a historical moment, even as it is imprisoned by the historical moment of its production and reception. We are not always writing through race, perhaps, but we are always writing through affairs, through and against erasure.
I want to focus on a couple of moments here, though, that Larissa alluded to, or was alluded to in her comments around a type of coalition building, particularly around within racialized communities, particularly right, communities of color and indigenous communities. And something that that Madeleine mentioned, which is a term that I find extremely useful, which is the notion of radical inclusion. And what I'd like to propose, I suppose, is that in combating this thing we call neoliberalism, and I'm never quite sure what that means, I have to admit, it slips through to me too much, but in combating that, it seems that this notion of radical inclusion is one that refuses to let things slide. It refuses to let the communities that we see go under the wheels stay under the wheels. And so it's a very important notion to me. So I'm wondering if there's some way to further address this as a necessary remedy to the powers that would say divide and conquer to create effective suppression, and by refusing to allow that suppression to happen to some to those apart from us, the individual, my community, what I call my community, if there's a possibility then to use that as a moment to start a revolution.
I just think that radical inclusion is from the reason why we put red into it. It looks like a minister. It was from the definition. The term radical inclusion was from yours and maybe Diana Bowles, and it was from someone else's people.
Sorry, I can't remember.
Where to begin? I would just say that for me, I'm very old-fashioned. I still believe, and this is in fact partly responsible to the first panel in solidarity with the first panel today, I still think that the phrase white supremacy is a perfectly valid phrase for describing the setup of our politics in Canada, and that everything else flows from that. And we can win skirmishes, a beautiful word. We can win skirmishes over representation in one particular institution or another, on one stage or another. et cetera, et cetera. But at the end of the day, the constitutionally mandated white supremacist discourse of Canada remains in place. The notion of the lying notion of 2,000 people who happen to be European, the fact that the head of state, whether anybody likes it or not, and the proof is on the money and on the stance for those who doubt this, this is not a republic. Our head of state happens to be somebody who lives overseas and is in charge of a church and only indigenous land, and only her family in perpetuity can be responsible in charge of this country constitutionally, et cetera, et cetera. Some of you may feel that these realities are simply symbolic. I don't. I don't think they're just simply symbolic. I think that they are constitutional, the fabric of this country. And so adopting the analysis that our first struggle, our major struggle, or at least part of our struggle, has to be to overturn this notion of white supremacy, I also ask that we consistently struggle and build our coalitions, et cetera, and analyze, and work to overthrow our oppressors. And just to give one concrete example of what I'm trying to indicate here, what I'm trying to get at, according to Statistics Canada, the First Nations population in Saskatchewan will soon be a majority in a few years. And I would like to see that majority turned into application of provincial power, state power, in quotation marks, by simply voting out the parties that are in place at the moment and putting in an Aboriginal, First Nations, Indigenous peoples friendly, solidarity, supportive government to use the power of the province under the Constitution of Canada to make it a native-run province for the benefit of Native people in general. Just for starters.
Referring to various racial and ethnic minorities. If we truly begin not just to know but to act on race, class, and gender, and by gender I mean not just women or men but LGBTQI, we become a majority in this country. And rather than sit around in cafes feeling good about this, concrete solidarity actions have to be taken, and we have the numbers to do it. We are constantly victims of lobster pot fascism in this country, where we just let the water rise and rise and rise. And Stephen Harper and his group are creating something that resembles no Canada we've ever known, including the bad ones, and eradicating our past, our present, and if they have their way, our future. And if we really unify around all the cross-pollinated lines we have, we are a majority. And I am as guilty as anybody else in allowing myself to feel good about it rather than do something about it. But please, please, please look at these things with an eye to what you can do and how many people you can bring with you. Thank you.
I'm struck by a number of things that seem dominant and deeply frustrating, and I just want a moment to frame the question. One is the predominance, rather the dominance of the university institutionalized space, even as we critique it, I find it pervasive. And the discourses, we can't seem to find our way out of nation and the nation state. I think I'd like to ask a question. For me, this is a room of a huge influence. The last 20 years of my life is with who I've been reading. I'm a little overwhelmed. But I'm, again, privileged. There's an access point there. And I work in a community, and as many people do, people who are multiply oppressed, at the same time, coarse race, coarse class, gender, as we think through that in a complex way, and so on and so on. And such that survival is the mainstay, that is the everyday. not this, and not our analysis. And for me, the white supremacist moment for sure can't be built from that capitalism. We need to talk about that directly. I have a question. The question is for Lenore. It was interesting to hear you describe that retreat after that violence of wedding tears 20 years ago, and the violence, of course, we perpetuate all the time. So, and the idea that you weren't doing the work, because clearly what amazing battle you were. And I want to ask about language. And beautifully, Lillian and Lee spoke to it in numerous ways and variously earlier. I fear that moment, the Punjabi translation, how amazing a moment that is. These moments still are not happening, so I'm not quite sure what we've advanced or what we think we've advanced in terms of language. And I think, looking to the leadership, I don't think Black Lives Matter no more. I don't think I don't know more. I just considered this too. Why? Because they can't be separated right now. I don't think these are equivalent to these historical moments. I can't believe that. Otherwise, I'm kind of lost. There's that hope goes, at this moment. So this is a change. We could always be in a change. Land, language. This is what I'm hearing from people that I respect. So I just wanted to talk, maybe practically, philosophically, language, and its meaning in terms of coalition.
Well, the elders tell us that that our language comes out of the land. And that's really, it's taken me a while to come to understand exactly how that happens. And I guess that's maybe one of the reasons I retreated from the city, to go back out and be closer to the land. For me, what has driven me, I think, has to do more with prophecy. It's a prophecy about the land, this place that we call Turtle Island. I was told by elders that Turtle Island is the place where the four colors of people will come together as one. And it doesn't mean that we're jumping into a melting pot. It means that we can come together with the diversity. We can come together with our diversity. And where we are as one is where we work for the common good. So respecting each other's uniqueness is really, really important. And because this is a prophecy, I mean, you're here because of the prophecy. And because we love the land, for me, I felt that I needed to work for you. Because we're sharing the land with you, all of you. Where I'm working now, I'm a federal employee, so I have to be careful what I say. But I'm working for Parks Canada, and I still see myself as doing my work as a storyteller and as a keeper of culture. Is I'm taking people out onto, and this, actually these parks are within my traditional homeland. So being there, I'm creating a presence. And I'm trying very hard not to be a flamethrower like I used to do in the olden days. I'm trying more to, kind of bring people around, just sort of, bring them over and give them a warm hug and take them out for a walk and teach them about the natural and the cultural history of the land. And the thing is, when you eat from the land, you become part of the land. So for me, this is how all of this ties together. The prophecy of Turtle Island with the four colors of people coming together as one, where we all work together for the common good, where we retain our way of honoring creation, keeping those special things, our languages, our foods, our cultural expressions. That's what it is. That's the connection. So I guess in another way, I'm urging you to come visit me up there, and we'll go for food.
I just want to add a little bit to what Lenore is saying, that prophecy is here in the coming together of Anishinaabe, Three Fires Council, and with the Haudenosaunee and the Treaty of the Dish with One Spoon. They brought together two constitutions which connect to the land and the sky and the water and the human beings. And just recently they found the document that was created by the people of this island that has the three colors of humans and the earth and the sky and the mandala and a scroll that goes with it. It's 800 years old, this document. They just recently found it on the prairies. But it's part of this territory, the sharing agreement that's there, that's between these two great confederacies, sets the tone for all the rest of the island for us. We extend welcome to you because this exists. This is our territoriality.
I am happy to be here, but I also feel the need to apologize for the question I need to ask. First, my apology. In rephrasing Lee's answer to the question, are things better? I would say, maybe, we don't have the right to buy and sell black people anymore. However, we often have the right to shoot them without being punished. Two. As an European, Eastern European immigrant, I have often felt as a colonizer in relationship to First Nations people, especially because I've been teaching for years in the performance space at Trent University, which is being reinvested for, I forgot how to say it. Well, it's a space of the First Nations ancestors, and we keep telling them there. Now my question. Because you opened the conference to non-white immigrants, what do you think about white but audible minorities? Because I am a white immigrant, because I am a theater professional, my foreign accent made in Canada my white skin irrelevant. Thank you very much.
I would like to answer. I have to give you an example. My husband is sitting in the audience here. that guy, that city boy. our son. Now, when all of this stuff is going on with with Dudley George at the, Indian country. There was the issue with Dudley George. There was Gustafson Lake out in BC. And in our community, in our traditional territory, there were what we call the fishing wars, where the anglers and hunters were against Saugeen Ojibwe nations practicing our Aboriginal and our treaty rights. And my husband was working on communications then in our community, and he would go toe to toe with the anglers and the hunters, and other opponents of the First Nations. Not that he would take the line, but he'd look and he'd see what was going on, and then he would alert our counselors and our chief and community people as to what was happening out there and where we should actually have some kind of response. So when he'd get up early in the morning to go out to these places, I'm left at home with the children, and I would tell our children that your daddy's going out to count coup. And he did. And he did it really well. Cool. It's really awesome. It was really good. Very powerful. Something to be proud of. Now, our son... He was just a little guy at that time, 4 or 5 years old. He's a Canadian, and he's Anishinaabe. He's white and he's native. He and I were driving somewhere. And suddenly he just leaned back in his chair, and he hunkered down. And he said, I hate white people. I wish God didn't create white people. And that just broke my heart, because that's part of his heritage too. And so I had to tell him, well, you know, if God didn't make white people, then you wouldn't be here. You wouldn't have your daddy. You wouldn't have your nana. Even me, I have a great-great-grandmother who is English. And I have a great-great-grandmother who is French. So if God didn't make white people, we wouldn't be here. And then I had to remind him of the medicine wheel. Here we go. And the four colors that are there. Now, remember I was telling you about the prophecy of Turtle Island, the four colors of people coming together? So that medicine wheel, to me, is a wheel of peace and harmony. And it shows the balance that needs to be there, and the balance that we need to fight for and recognize and keep. Because if you take the white acid, it's not a medicine here anymore. It's incomplete and it's unbalanced. So, you know what I think? I think it's, I like it. Disrupting anything, etc. I'm just sort of repeating to then ask you. You say that you find that your Eastern European accent or European accent renders your white skin irrelevant in certain places, and I'm asking, irrelevant to whom?
May I just add something? Two things really interest me. Okay. Two things interest me, and one in your apology, that you would apologize for black people being shot and... Yes, and that's the other thing that interests me. You said that you were a colonizer. Oh, dear. I am an immigrant in this country, and one of the first things that I recognized shortly after, you know, I come from a country where in carnival, it's Indians. It's a trope in carnival. I didn't know anything about indigenous people, and when I came here, I started learning, and it quickly occurred to me that I had a choice to be a colonizer or not, even as a person of color. Now, the indigenous people I have met have, I don't know if, I mean, I'm not all indigenous people are like this, but I sure know Leos, and I'm hearing this from Lenore, who I've not met before, but are very, very generous about our presence here. And I would like to say that I have a choice not to apologize for blacks being shot, but to do something about it. I do not want to take on that responsibility or role. There's something of being one to apologize for it. And in terms of being a colonizer, I will not accept that rule. I will work against it. And the other thing is that I have heard so many people say, so thankfully not so much now, but over the course of my many years here, assert their whiteness while apologizing for it. And that to me is, it's nauseating. Because it is asserting, I don't know, maybe you can figure out why it is. It's a kind of, you see, I actually write a lot better when I speak. It's asserting the power you have with this kind of little apology. So I'm sorry, I hear what you're saying, but I would like to stand up to
it. This renders your skin color irrelevant, but I must say, I have a perfect Canadian accent. The only other language I speak is French, and it does not seem to render my skin color irrelevant.
Can I? So, work that doesn't just reduce us to marginality, and I'm interested in your thoughts on that, in a place where we can think systemically and also really be rooted in particular experiences that speak to who we are more fully instead of just our marginality.
I just need to repeat the question because some folks couldn't hear. So the question, you can tell me if I have it right or not. The question was about, are there ways in which we can make our writing, do our art, in ways that, so that we, that don't reduce us to marginality, so that are more expansive than that. Do they have you right? Okay, well, good.
Oh, a couple of things, very quickly. First of all, I think we should remember this is also the 50th anniversary of the publication of John Porter's Vertical Mosaic. And I want to point that out. Now, hold on. I need to point that out because of the fact that the analysis that Porter puts forward, that everyone who is non-white Anglo-Saxon Protestant is produced on a pyramid of sliding values with black people and native people at the bottom. That was true in 1965. It is still true today. But it also means that those who are considered to have accents are also positioned beneath those who supposedly don't have access, et cetera, et cetera. That does not negate the operation of racial discrimination, which, of course, as we know in this conference, and it was true 20 years ago, is still true today, and perhaps even in some ways more true today, because of the fact that we have the veneer of multiculturalism, because of the fact we have the veneer of the rhetoric of anti-racism, the suggestions put forward that things are necessarily better. No. I think that the art of the oppressor has been to understand that it's possible to create opportunities, even within an overarching oppression, to allow, again, for small, in some cases, short-lived triumphs of representation. Oh, there's so-and-so from that group over there in that position. There's so-and-so from another group in, over there in another position. And to make it seem as if, because of this wallpaper of Benetton, color, and accent, for that matter, diversity, that things have necessarily opened up. They have not. In fact, things have become more entrenched. What I describe as white supremacy also includes capitalist, patriarchal domination of this society. And it all is rooted in the Western European imperialism that divided up this globe 500 years ago and still is under different names today. Whether you want to call it North American Free Trade, whether you want to call it the Eurozone, whether you want to think about the world being divided into three major trading blocks, with two of them, again, Europe and the Americas, being dominated by Caucasians, who are intent on keeping the economic power for themselves. I do not apologize for arguing in terms of an analysis. I'm going to get to talk about writing in a moment. But I do not apologize for an analysis that insists that one potential solution, or partial solution at least, to situations of oppression is overturning the power that utilizes that oppression, sincerely targeting it and overturning it. So I do think that, yes, I'll repeat, Native people should take power in Saskatchewan. That would represent self-government without having to have any more First Nations, or sorry, First Ministers conferences about it. That would be self-government, at least in one way, shape, or form. I also believe in terms of economics, and I do believe that all of our oppression ultimately is rooted in economics. Theft of land from Aboriginal people, theft of labor from Black people and brown people, for crying out loud. That's the history of the imperialism that has constructed the oppressions that we are still struggling against today. In terms of economics, once again, I truly believe, I'll say it again, that property taxes, a portion of property taxes collected all across this country, should go to First Nations people. Absolutely. And to start giving First Nations people a real ability for economic takeoff, whoever that's going to be defined, et cetera, et cetera. But I don't think it should be rooted to basically being able to have access to running casinos, et cetera, et cetera. No. Shift a portion of the property tax to First Nations. I've talked too much. I'm going to shut up. But I just wanted to say about the writing, and this is going back to the first panel as well. Look, I really like Lillian's statement about being subjective and absolutely subjective and rereading the history, looking at history from our perspective, understanding the construction of the Canadian state from our perspective, and writing those narratives and that poetry and those plays and those film scripts that are meant to show the oppression without apology, and also suggest narratives for escaping it, getting rid of it. Finally, finally, without a whole lot of romantic, sentimental folderol.
It resonates with me, and I recognize in parts, but I really am a writer and an artist, and so it's the writing part that I come back to. And I see, I think it's like, the way I'm sitting here and looking at the conference, you know, the first Writing Through Race conference, I was a visual artist, and when I went, I realized, oh my gosh, there's a conference to do, and I think it's something I should go to. And I ran to it, and they were just packing up the tables. So I wasn't there, but I'm looking at, I'm looking at the conference now, and I say, wow, I think, wow, we just get sidetracked once again by race, and where's the writing part? And I just wonder, you know, the one part of writing, as irrelevant as publishers, editors, agents, and so on are today, I think,
I don't put your hands up, but are any publishers, agents, editors, critics here today? To me, that would be another important step.
I'm so aware that we're at time.
I see a question
from Sarnet. Okay. Oh, fine, great. Okay, so the hashtag is writing through race or 20YRS. 2014YRS through race. Okay. All right, for the Twitterers. I'm so sorry, folks. Shani, do you want to say
I just want to say something. Okay. I do actually recognize that this is a problem. It's that Smaro is so involved in so much of this activism that I forget that you are actually a publisher who needs to be named.
I'm so sorry.
Oh, Larissa.
Okay. I'm going to finish with the poem.
Right. All right. Old poem. All right. And from memory, better work. Here it goes. Look homeward, exile. I can still see that soil crimsoned by butchered hog. And imbrued with rye, lime, and homely spirituals, everybody must know. Still dream of folk who broke a crack like shale. Pushkin twisted his hands in boxing. Morocco who ran girls like dogs and got stabbed. Lavinia, her teeth decayed to black stumps, her lovemaking still in demand, spitting black phlegm. Her pension after 20 pounds. And Toof suckled on anger that no Baptist church could contain. Who let sprinkled Ely seed her moist wound. When she was just 13. And the tyrant son that reared from barbed wire spewed flame that charred the idiot crops to depression and hurt my granddaddy to bottle after bottle of sweet death, his dreams beaten to one tremendous pulp until his heart seized, choked, his love gave out. But beauty survived, secreted in freight trains snorting in their pins, in babes whose faces were cold black mirrors and strange drummers with silk and alien dandles hummed. Blind, blues, precise, ornate, rich needlepoint, and then by love's dark, orient skin that smelled like orange peels and tasted like rum. Good God, I remember my creator in the old ways. I sit in taverns and stare at my fists. I met earth into bread, spell water into wine. Still nothing warms my wintry exile, neither prayers nor fine love, neither votes nor hard drink. For nothing heals those saints bound in green beds by love or pain. A screw jammed in thick, straining wood.
Okay.